this week. We're so glad you could join us as we continue the series Living Inside Out. We're looking at the first 12 chapters of Acts and discovering how the inner walk of the church with God fueled their outer witness and life in this world. We also want to say Happy Canada Day. And as we begin this week, we're going to stand together, or invite you to stand together wherever you are as we sing O Canada.
Welcome to today's service. Our call to worship will be taken from the book of John, chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. Jesus said, "A time is coming and has now come when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and in truth." Let us be those worshippers whom God seeks. Let us praise Him. Thank you.
We are so blessed by the gifts from your hand. I just can't understand why you love us so much. We are so blessed. We just can't find a way for the words that can say. Thank you, Lord, for your touch when we're my heart, oh God.
Today's scripture is from Acts chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. A great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Then some of the young men came forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter asked her, "Tell me, is this the price you and Ananias got for the land?" "Yes," she said, "that is the price." Peter said to her, "How could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also." At that moment, she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in and, finding her dead, carried her out and buried her beside her husband. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events.
We have this summer been exploring a series called Living Inside Out. As we dig into some of the stories of the early church in the book of Acts, the first 12 chapters. And we've been finding that as the Spirit came with inside them and as they cultivated their inner relationship with God, that empowered their outer walk with one another and in their world as they shared the gospel as the church grew and expanded. This morning, or today, we're talking about a couple who didn't have that inner strength and the disaster that it brought to their lives as we look at the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Earlier this week, though, Don McFadden of Prince Edward Island went public with an embarrassing story of losing $17,000 to a computer scam. A message had popped up on his computer screen claiming that someone was trying to hack into his bank account and he would be contacted by phone and told and given instructions on how to save his money, how to keep the people from stealing his money. Well, when the phone call came, the scammer told Mr. McFadden to take his money out of his account and transfer it into a Bitcoin machine in Charlottetown. And that's what he did. He didn't get suspicious until the scammer then asked him to spend thousands of dollars on Google Play cards. And then Mr. McFadden thought, I better go to the police and see what's going on. By then, however, it was too late for him to get his $17,000 back. Probably the largest financial liar of all time was Bernie Madoff, who over a period of 20 to 30 years ran a Ponzi scheme that defrauded about 4,800 people out of about $64 billion. A Ponzi scheme is named after Charles Ponzi, who in the 1920s, over a period of several months, defrauded several people, a lot of investors, out of several million dollars. The way the scheme worked is, you invite people to invest in your finance company, and then you, instead of putting that money to work, instead of investing that money, you actually keep it for yourself, and then you pay back your first investors with later investors who come in. And so, in that way, you keep the Ponzi scheme going. Well, when Madoff was arrested in December of 2008, he claimed he'd only been operating this scheme since the 1990s. But the FBI believe it could have gone back all the way to the 1980s or even as early as the 1970s. So how did he get away with it for so long? Well, he lived his whole life as a lie. He lived the life of a successful financial genius. He gave money to charities, he supported political parties, he had some of his family members who were part of the security and finance industry boards. He was on the chair. He was the chair of the National Association of Security Dealers. And he was friends with the chair of the Security and Exchange Commission. And when some of the Security and Exchange Commission investigators started looking at Bernie's numbers and thought something was wrong, they were first told by their bosses to stop the investigation. They must be wrong. There must be something else going on because Bernie is so successful. And in fact, just a year before Bernie was arrested, he was the guest speaker at a conference, and he gave a talk about illegal practices on Wall Street. And he said this, "In today's regulatory environment, it's virtually impossible to violate the rules." Well, for 30 years, he had lived a lie. He had fooled some of the brightest financial minds in the world. And after confessing that his whole company was just one big lie, he ended up being sentenced to 150 years in prison. Kind of makes the lie of Ananias and Sapphira pale in comparison. It's a strange and disturbing story, isn't it? After four chapters of amazing church growth, miracles, wonderful fellowship, suddenly, Luke includes this story of fraud and deception by prominent members of the early church. Why would Luke even include such an embarrassing story in what should have been a chronicle of the church's success after success in the ancient world? And why such a harsh punishment for lying? Where was the grace? Where was the opportunity for repentance and forgiveness? How come no one told Sapphira about her husband's death 3 hours earlier before her arrival? It just seems like a strange interruption put into a story about a successful movement of the gospel going all around the world. Well, Ananias and Sapphira's story actually falls naturally into the progression of the story of Acts. It is for us today a reminder that no church, not even the first church, which we so often like to idealize, no church is a perfect church. The story is told of a man who came to the famous preacher Charles Spurgeon. He was asking Spurgeon for help to find a good church, to find the perfect church. And Spurgeon is said to have told the man this, that if you ever find a church just like that, a perfect church, do not join it, because the moment you join it, it will no longer be a perfect church. Churches are made up of Christians saved by grace who are in the process of being made in the image of Christ. But that process is not complete until we enter into God's glory. So here on earth, we're still going to make our mistakes. Churches will not be perfect because Christians are not yet perfect. We might forget that if we simply stopped at the end of Acts chapter 4, because there we find this short, amazing story about what sounds like a perfect church. Luke writes at the end of chapter 4, "All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed any possessions were their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them that there was no needy person among them." Luke goes on to say how from time to time people would sell property and bring the money to the disciples to give to people who were in need. Acts chapter 4 ends with this beautiful example. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field that he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. This is our first introduction to a man the Acts will call Barnabas. He will become an important figure in the story. Barnabas will later be the one who is a mentor for Paul. He will become a co-pastor of the first fully Gentile church in Antioch. He will be one of the first missionaries who is sent out by that same church. He later becomes an advocate for John Mark, and he gives that young leader a second chance that changes, helps us eventually have the gospel. He is a humble, caring, reliable, well-loved leader in the early church. And you can see how much Barnabas is appreciated in those last verses in Acts chapter 4. His given name is not Barnabas, it's Joseph. Barnabas is his nickname. It's the name the apostles gave to him. Bar means son, Nabas literally means prophet, but Acts tells us that the apostles got a little more specific and called him son of encouragement. Someone who speaks encouragement or blessing into other people's lives. Someone who comes alongside of others to help them along, like he did for Paul, like he did for Mark. He was an ordinary guy. He wasn't a profound teacher, he wasn't a charismatic leader, but he was a guy who helped other people reach their full potential. He became a leader of leaders, as it were. And it seems pretty clear that Ananias and Sapphira noticed Barnabas. They heard the story. They heard people talking. Joseph sold all of his land and they gave all the money to the apostles to help feed the poor. No wonder they call him Barnabas. Isn't he an amazing guy? Aren't we so blessed to have him as a part of our church? Ananias and Sapphira probably thought, well, he's no better than us. How come people are talking all about him and not talking about us like that? How come people don't recognize that we are a blessing to have in this church as members of this congregation? We want that recognition too. We want people talking about how great we are. And so Ananias and Sapphira hatched a plan together. Acts makes it clear that Ananias sold the property and with his wife's full knowledge kept some of the money back for themselves. That way they could make a big public donation, but they wouldn't have to give it all. People would just think that they gave it all. They wanted the reputation of being generous at a discounted price. They wanted the credit and the prestige of being sacrificially generous without the inconvenience of actually giving all the money. They wanted a reputation they did not deserve, and so they told a lie. Their motive was not to help the poor, but it was indeed to feed their own ego. Well, you heard what happened as Kendall read it to us. When Ananias came in, Peter knew right away that he was lying. He knew that Ananias was saying that he gave all the money, but he really held some back. Peter reprimanded Ananias, and then Ananias fell down dead. 3 hours later, Sapphira comes in, and not knowing what happened, Peter gives her the opportunity to set the record straight. But she stuck with the lie, and so she too fell down dead. And fear and awe went throughout the whole church, and everyone who heard about it were in awe and fear of God. Well, here's the lesson for the week. It's a tongue twister. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Try saying it 4 or 5 times really fast. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Can't say it really fast. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. If Ananias and Sapphira had known this, if Ananias and Sapphira had known their Bible, they might not have tried to lie to the church and to God. It's a very similar sounding story, actually, in the book of Joshua in the Old Testament. After the destruction of Jericho, all the plunder of that city was supposed to be devoted to God. No one was supposed to keep anything out of all of it. It was as if they were, in a sense, as they were gaining a foothold in the promised land, they were giving to God the first fruits, the first tithe of everything they were about to receive. except not everyone did. Joshua chapter 7, we read that Achan saw a beautiful Babylonian robe, a couple hundred shekels of silver, along with 50 shekels of gold. And he thought, nobody's going to miss this. And it would be a shame to waste it on just giving it as an offering to God. So he took it. He took it all and he buried it under his tent, holding on to it for a rainy day. Well, Achan's deceit was held against the whole nation. And in the next battle at the city of Ai, which should have been an easy win, should have been an easy conquering for them, it ended in a humiliating defeat. The people began then to live in fear that they would not even be able to take the promised land. Joshua 7:5 says, the people's hearts melted in fear like water. Well, the next day, Joshua gathered the whole nation together and he slowly called up all 12 tribes. And Judah's lot was chosen. Then he called all the clans of Judah together and Zariah's clan was chosen as the lot. Then the families of Zerites came up and the family of Zimri had the lot fall against them. And then the family of Zimri came forward and the lot fell on Achan. And God had found him out in amongst all of the people. Achan then confessed his deceit. The hidden loot was found and destroyed, and Achan himself was stoned. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Let's break that down a bit. Faking faith. Barnabas gave out of a genuine heart for God and for the needs of others. Ananias and Sapphira's hearts were stirred by Barnabas' generous action, but they were not stirred for the same reason. They were motivated by a desire to look good. Their fake faith was, on many levels, a lie. The most obvious was that they were lying to the church. Peter said, "You have not just lied to people," implying they had indeed lied to people as well as others. They were lying to the congregation, they were lying to the apostles, they were lying to anyone they hoped would hear about their gift. They were trying to present themselves as something that they were not. They were lying to people. Beyond that, Peter says that they were lying to God. Sin, all sin, is a sin against God. After he committed adultery against Uriah and Bathsheba, David wrote in his great confession to God in Psalm 51, "Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight." All sin, all lies, whether against God directly or not, are acts of rebellion against God. And thirdly, Ananias and Sapphira lied to themselves. They were telling themselves, "We can commit this fraud and no one will know." But God always knows. They were telling themselves, "We can commit this fraud and everything will be all right. God won't care and nothing bad is going to happen." Well, they weren't all right. They were lying to themselves. So what did God desire? Simply put, God desired honesty. Peter said, "Look, the land was yours. You did not have to sell it. Selling the land was not God's command to you. Though people were doing it, selling land and giving the money to the church, it was not compelled by God or the apostles or anyone." Peter said, "After you sold the land, the money was yours. You could have done with it what you wanted. God did not require them to give all of the money to the church. They could have given some of it. They could have given none of it. They could have given all of it." Where Ananias and Sapphira went wrong was that they gave some of it and said they were giving all of it to make themselves look impressive to others. Well, God doesn't need to be impressed. God will take us as we are. That is His grace. That is His love for us. And so we need to be honest with God ourselves. Throughout the scriptures, we see again and again God's desire for honest and open relationships. You remember the story of Job, who in the midst of his suffering begins to cry out to God. And he cries out to God, "I've done nothing wrong. Why are you doing this to me?" He accuses God of punishing him for no reason. God, in the end, says that it was Job who spoke honestly about him and tells Job's friends, "You have lied about my character. You better get Job to pray for you." The woman at the well, Jesus asked her to go get her husband, and she said, "I have no husband." Jesus said, "Technically, yeah, that's right. You have no husband. You have had 5 husbands, and the guy that you're with now won't even take you as his wife." God can handle our honesty. That's simply what he desires. If we have doubts, take them to God. If we are angry, express it to the Father. If we are fearful, lean into Jesus. If we're exhausted, tell the Holy Spirit. If we are hurting, be open with God. If we are confused, talk it out with Jesus. God can handle our honesty. But faking our faith is futile because God our Father already knows what's in our hearts. He doesn't desire our cliches. He doesn't desire our nice-sounding prayers that we really don't mean. He seeks a real, honest relationship. And God is God, and he can handle our honesty. Well, what about the second half of our phrase? Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. Fearfully. I think I mentioned last week the verses in Scripture which tell us the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 tells us, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love." God does not want us to be fearful in the sense that we feel afraid of him, like we would be afraid of a ruthless tyrant. So what does Acts chapter 5 mean then when it says, "Great fear seized the church"? Well, there are some things of which it is appropriate to be fearful of. We should be afraid, for example, of putting our hand on a hot stove. That keeps us from getting our hand burned. Fear can be helpful when it alerts us to danger or helps us make wise decisions. In the thunderstorm earlier this month, we lost one of the fruit trees on our property. When Hurricane Arthur hit 6 years ago, we lost a tree at that time as well, and my dad came up with his chainsaw and cut the tree up for us. Well, he couldn't come this time, and I don't own a chainsaw. And truth is, I've never wanted to own a chainsaw. When I was a child, a family friend that we call Uncle David was cutting up a log with a chainsaw when he hit a knot, and the saw kicked back onto his face and literally cut his nose off. He survived, and it all got sewn back together. And though I never actually saw the accident, I remember very clearly seeing the scars. And so I just figured, if I never touch a chainsaw, I'll never cut my nose off. Well, my dad could not come this time to cut up the tree, so after 5 decades of life, I finally broke down and bought an electric chainsaw. I also bought a hard hat and ear protectors and eye protection and thick leather gloves that went up my wrists. I put on my steel-toed boots, and I nervously pulled the trigger on my new chainsaw. I'm happy to say that I survived with all of my limbs intact, and my nose is still on my face. But I still had to treat the chainsaw with respect. I still needed to wear the proper safety equipment and practice good chainsaw skills. I actually looked it up on YouTube first and got some ideas and some pointers there. Treating a chainsaw with respect and using it properly is an appropriate kind of fear because it teaches us to do things properly. Well, when Luke says great fear seized the church, I think he was trying to tell us that the church and the people around realized that God is holy and sovereign and that he's worthy of respect. They understood that he should be approached with reverence and not disrespect, that the fear of the Lord is a recognition of the awe and the majesty of God. And I think Acts is trying to tell us that we should have a healthy fear of sin, a sense of the danger and the harm that can come into our life if we persist in rebelling against God. We live in a world which says, if it feels good, then go ahead and do it. It's good to do. Do whatever you want. We live in a world which believes that the fear of sin spoils our fun. But the world is wrong. The pleasures of sin are only momentary, and then there is the danger which comes when we violate God's will and violate what makes us truly human. True, lasting, eternal joy is found in the context of a real relationship with God. And while some people might say that the fun of sin is better than living in fear, I think that when we have a healthy sense of the fear of the consequences of sin, we will avoid sin. I think back to the story of the first sin in the Garden of Eden. And I wonder if Adam and Eve had known, had stopped to consider the consequences of their disobedience, all that they lost, not just that sentence of death, but those walks in the garden with God, would they have still disobeyed? If we avoid enslaving ourselves to sin, we create room in our lives for those things that bring true joy, lasting joy. We are free to enjoy a deep and a long-lasting relationship with a loving Heavenly Father. With David, we can say to our Father, "You have made known to me the path of life. You have filled me with joy in your presence, and eternal pleasures are mine at your right hand." A healthy fear is about a proper reverence for God and a fear of the consequences of sin, a fear of breaking the heart of God. And those are things that do not take away life's joy, but which open us up to the true joy as we make room in our life for a real relationship with God. Faking faith in front of the Father is fearfully futile. So let us, in our daily lives, in our walk with God, live honestly with Him and with one another. And let us live in joy as we walk with God and walk with His people. Thank you for joining us again this week. It has been a joy to be able to share these moments with you. And as we conclude, may indeed the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn towards you and give you joy and peace. In Jesus' name, amen.